What are child rights? Once upon a time, not so very long ago, and not so far away, some grown-ups realised what children had been saying all along. Children have special rights that need to be recognised and protected. All children, big and little children, all kinds of children, who live in all kinds of homes, who are special in many different ways, and you. Your family will help you with your rights. The right to eat healthy food. The right to go to school. The right to learn many things. The right to care when you are sick. The right to be cared for by your parents. The right to be cared for if you do not live with your parents. The right to have a name and belong to a country. The right to choose your friends. The right to think for yourself. The right to share your ideas and be listened to. The right to live and grow. The right to special help if you need it. The right to be treated fairly by everyone. The right to never be hurt by others. The right to not have to work too hard. The right to be kept safe from dangerous things. The right to learn to be the best you can. The right to play. The right to rest. The right to be private. The right to speak your own language. The right to have adults do what is best for you. What is your favourite right? Welcome to our professional development presentation on children's rights. This presentation will examine children's rights, with the core focus being Article 12 from the Convention on the Rights of a Child, which states, children have the right to say what they think should happen when adults are making decisions that affect them and to have their opinions taken into account. General analysis of children's rights will be presented by Monique Harding. Sociology of children's rights in education will be presented by Becky Higgins. Children's participation rights in an Australian education context will be presented by Danielle Renner. Practical examples of participation rights in an early childhood education context will be presented by Christy Lee Henriksen. Practical examples, what does Article 12 look like in practice in a primary school setting, will be presented by Alicia Bonnet. Each section of the presentation will have a unit of questions to actively involve you in each aspect of our presentation. Thank you.
I'm Monique and I'm going to be going through the general analysis. The term child comes from the Latin infants, which means that cannot speak, without speech, mute or speechless. This term is used when speaking of children up to the age of 7. This concept of a child being unable to speak as such until the age of 7 has thankfully evolved throughout the centuries. However, this notion has not been completely eradicated in some cultures. In contrast to the Latin origin, the Convention on the Rights of the Child defines the term child as any human being below the age of 18 years. This definition ensures that children are classified as human beings, therefore are entitled to rights and dignity. If we take a look at past teaching and present day teaching, and we compare the two, we look at the concept of childhood throughout history, we become aware that it has not always been seen as a special part of life. Prior to the 20th century, many believed it was merely a transitional state between infancy and adulthood. Children would begin work as soon as they were old and strong enough, and education was reserved for the privileged. As some countries became wealthier, childhood began to move to a time of education, recreation, growth, and discovery. Despite this, childhood remains a time of hardship for many children. This is the reason behind the United Nations Convention on the Rights of the Child, which we will look at a little bit later on in the presentation. If we look at present-day teaching, today most children and young people growing up in Australia experience a safe, healthy, and positive environment. However, there are still many children experiencing things like homelessness, mental issues. And these children, along with the children with disabilities, children in immigration detention, and Indigenous children can be at risk of falling through the gaps. Although there has been tremendous improvement throughout the 20th century, we still find that the voices of children and young people are rarely heard when decisions are made about the issues that affect their lives. This presentation will focus heavily on this particular issue. If we take a look at children's rights and what it means, in order to understand the value of children's rights in education, we must first recognise the purpose of children's rights itself and what it entails. So the purpose. Children's rights are human rights. Children are human. The rights are there to protect the child as a human being. Human and children rights are constituted by fundamental guarantees and essential human rights. If we take a look at these children's rights, here are some of the categories that the Convention on the Rights of the Child cover. So there's 5 points and they provide a brief outline for the content of the convention. So if we take a look at the first one, we've got children's rights recognise fundamental guarantees to all human beings. The right to life, the non-discrimination principle, the right to dignity through the protection of physical and mental integrity. So the protection against slavery, torture and bad treatments. Then we have the civil and political rights, so the right to identity, the right to a nationality. Then we have the economic, social and cultural rights, so the right to education, the right to a decent standard of living, the right to health. Then we have individual rights, so the right to live with their parents, again the right to education, and the right to benefit from a protection. Then we have the collective rights, so the rights of refugee and disabled children, and of minority children's. So taking a look at the Convention on the Rights of the Child, there are 54 articles in the Convention, each of which are extremely important. Here we see some of those articles, and the focus of this presentation is going to be Article 12. So we take a look at Article 12, and it says, children have the right to say what they think should happen when adults are making decisions that affect them and have their opinions taken into account. This is an extremely important article, especially in education, as each student has a different learning method and benefits differently from our teaching. It is so important for children in our classroom to have a say on the decisions of how they learn. Obviously, there still needs to be structure, somewhat of a structure, and the learning is vital, but students learn differently, and therefore we need to be looking after each different student, and they need to be getting the best possible educational experience. There is a divergence of opinion between teachers across educational settings on the matter of student voice. Today we experience teachers who are perhaps more traditional in their views, and then we have the complete opposite, teachers who believe that the child should have the main voice and control. Teachers must adopt an active willingness to include children's perspectives on educational matters affecting them, rather than having little trust in the children's capacity to hold or express a valid opinion. Sargent and Gillett-Swan discuss how there is a dominant view remaining that the child's voice is worthy of only selective attention. They state that where children are not trusted to think for themselves on matters of importance, they are considered more susceptible to the need to connect with their peers than with educational concerns. The United Nations Convention on the Rights of the Child provides children with a significant platform to express their views on issues affecting their lives. However, in many settings, educational practice in particular, children's perspectives continue to be seldom sought and rarely acted upon. In the modern classroom, teachers need to implement and grow the use of concepts such as Article 12 in order to see students flourish. So we have a question here. So throughout the course of this presentation, we're going to delve more in depth into the implications of Article 12 and how we as teachers can ensure our students are being looked after. And their rights are being looked after. So the question I would like to pose is this. As teachers, how can we ensure that we are applying Article 12 in our classrooms, and what would that look like practically? So keep in mind that as you continue to view this presentation, just keep that question in your mind, and at the end, could you please write an answer using the knowledge we provided, as well as any ideas you might have outside of this presentation.
Hi, my name is Becky, and I'm going to discuss with you the sociology of children's rights and education. I would like you to take a moment to think about what you believe the sociology of children's rights and education might entail. The sociology of childhood critiques the term development for its emphasis on the differences between children and adults that sees children as needy and becoming. Instead, the sociology of childhood focuses on valuing each child's current experiences and understanding and their being. Seeking children's perspective about issues in which they are involved in or issues that affect them is a relatively new concept in areas such as health, education, and community involvement. Yet, it is a critical element in the UN Convention on the Rights of the Child. The theoretical frameworks that make up children's rights and sociology of childhood recognise, one, that children construct their social worlds, two, that they are persons, not property, three, that they constitute multiple voices rather than a collective and undifferentiated class, and four, that childhood should be given as high, if not higher, priority as to adulthood. Contemporary Western perspectives focus on children as dependents rather than agents, whereas at other times in history, as well as other cultures, children were and are given huge responsibilities. In most Western countries, children in family and educational settings are often not allowed to participate in the decision-making process that shape and structure their everyday lives and education. The nature of childhood and the beliefs about what children are capable of vary at different times in history and in different cultural settings. Childhood and children's needs are socially constructed. In other words, they are what they think they are. It seems in many educational settings, children are not understood to be capable, competent, responsible, and able to contribute to decisions. Like women 20 or 30 years ago, children are considered to be weak, vulnerable, in need of protection, and lacking in control over what happens to them. Children have been the invisible and mute objects of concern, and have not been understood as agents who have a point of view about the world. However, voice and agency are two fundamental components in the new discipline of childhood studies. Voice refers to that cluster of intentions, hopes, grievances, and expectations that children guard as their own. And agency defines how children express their voice and suggests that children are much more self-determining actors than we really think. Children's agency must be balanced by their dependency, and in many instances, children must participate as co-actors with others, including adults. Children have a unique perspective and point of view, which has often been ignored in the past. This marginalisation comes about because children are considered to lack confidence and experience, and their viewpoints on the world are thought to be merely a reflection of what their parents or teachers think. Children are seen primarily in terms of their vulnerability and need to be protected, and that gaining their views might cause them harm, which is another reason children's perspectives are not gained or are ignored. Kitzinger argues that instead of seeing children as victims, we should be working on enhancing children's coping strategies and ability to have control over their own lives. This means changing assumptions about childhood and social and political contexts. Children's need for protection by adults and from adults would be substantially reduced if they had more access to social, economic, and political resources. If children are to exercise participation rights, there must be opportunities and situations where they have the opportunity to make choices and participate in decisions. With children's days, time, and movements largely decided for them by adults, children's opportunities for expressing their ideas and their active participation outside the home, school, or community have diminished, as children are often protected and excluded. Rethinking childhood to include their voice is essential to readdress the balance and is likely to enhance children's capability of contributing to society as active citizens. So, having agency means being able to make choices and decisions to influence events and to have an impact on one's world. As children develop a sense of agency, they realize that they have the ability to make their own decisions and to control their own lives. A sense of agency is an important part of a strong sense of identity. So thinking about this, how do you support children to develop a sense of agency? What opportunities are there in your setting for children to make meaningful decisions and choices about things that affect them? What aspects of their day can children control themselves? Although sociologists of childhood emphasize children's agency, it is also important to recognize that agency arises out of a social and cultural context. Sociocultural theory recognizes that agency arises out of social relationships, where as social beings, children are inherently agentive and they voice their views in order to be heard, to persuade, to move others into action. As children act and ask to be heard, they are both building and experiencing their social reality and constructing their identity in the process. These are both parts of a mutual and ongoing construction. Because sociocultural theory is based on the idea that learning occurs in social and cultural contexts, it also involves the way that people use cultural tools to develop. These tools include physical tools of a community, such as technologies, and also symbolic tools, including spoken and written languages, mathematical and musical symbols. A very important idea in sociocultural theory is that when people learn to use cultural tools, it helps them to think and reflect in different ways. This means they are able to contribute to the social context they inhabit. The contributions people make to their social context then change how the context operates. This can be seen when infants learn to talk, because language expands their opportunities for social interaction, and so they change what is happening around them by contributing to conversations and social events. This change supports the child's further development because the context continues to offer new experiences for learning. In early childhood education, many ideas are commonly associated with the sociocultural theory, such as the importance of social interactions between children, adults, and peers to build knowledge, and the role of children's home and family experiences. Teachers interested in using sociocultural theory value how strong social and community relationships create opportunities for supporting learning and see development as connected to the experiences children have in their families and homes as well as their educational settings. To promote children's exercise and participation rights, it's essential to experience responsive social relationships and interactions. Children first of all need the opportunity to participate in progressively more complex patterns of reciprocal activity if they are to benefit from the support and guidance of skilled partners. Bronfenbrenner views children as active, developing individuals engaging in reciprocal relationships. In this sense, the child, other people, and the environment all play a role in contributing to the child's development. Therefore, teaching and learning in the classroom are influenced by social and political structures and the broad overarching beliefs, values, and ideologies of the culture. Children are unlikely to be able to express a view unless they have the conditions which help them to formulate their views. Sociocultural theory suggests that children become competent through participating in activities that are beyond their current level of skills or in their zone of proximal development. Vygotsky's theory focused on how development occurs in and cannot be separated from social and cultural activities. Of special interest to teachers are his writings on the developmental processes, the use of cultural inventions or tools, and how children's development is best guided by people who are experienced in using these tools. His ideas help us understand the relationship between individuals and their culture, such as how children develop high mental processes, as well as the tools and skills that are deemed important in their culture. His concept of the zone of proximal development has contributed significantly to to our understanding and reconstruction of the role of the teacher, as well as of collaborative learning among children. Rogoff sees working in the zone of proximal development as the process of guided participation. Guided participation, or scaffolding within the zone of proximal development, helps us understand the importance of knowing the children we teach and being sensitive to their ways of thinking and knowing. The child is not a passive recipient of knowledge from the teacher, nor is the teacher an expert of knowledge. It's together they are participants in joint problem solving, sharing information and responsibility. Scaffolding is the temporary structure used to support a building as it is being built or repaired. It helps to hold everything together until the building is able to stand by itself. In education, scaffolding refers to the way in which educators help to support and extend children's learning. Like scaffolding on a building, our involvement and careful questioning and suggestions can help to support children's learning while it is taking place. With our support, children's learning often becomes richer and more valuable than it would otherwise. So let's think about this. Think about the ways in which you support or scaffold children's learning. How do you know when to involve yourself, to ask a question or make a comment or suggestion, and when to just watch? How do you ask questions or make suggestions that encourage children's thinking rather than shutting it down? Children learn developmentally by doing what they don't know how to do. So therefore, they benefit from being viewed as competent learners and given the opportunity to learn in partnership with others. Joint involvement with others is challenging learning activities. Feeling comfortable, accepted, and tuned into other participants in a group, and group members being sensitive to them, is likely to contribute to effective participation. Adult support can capture the young person's interest, help focus on a goal, draw attention to critical features of the task, and reduce the complexity of the task. But there has to be social engagement before children can learn and gradually take on more responsibility. If we begin to value who children are, not just what we want them to be, a shift happens in the way we think about learning and teaching. Our jobs become more engaging and fulfilling. We also begin to envision a larger purpose of our profession, making childhood visible and valued for the ways in which it can enrich our humanity and contribute to our collective identity.
Hi, my name is Danielle, and I'm going to lead you through a discussion about participation rights in the context of educational settings. We'll start with a practical scenario and a reflection, and then I'll move into a discussion about Article 12 within the Convention on the Rights of the Child and its relation to participation. From there, I'll discuss what participation within an education context means and what it does not. And lastly, I'll finish with the research and theory surrounding children's participation rights and how it suggests we engage children meaningfully in an educational setting. So we'll start with the scenario. And for this particular scenario, I want everybody to close their eyes while I tell the story. Okay. It's 2002 on a sunny spring day in a Brisbane childcare service in the 3 to 4 years frame. It's a Thursday, which means at 1 o'clock, it's programming time. At 1 o'clock, the group leader takes all of her folders up to the office and starts pulling out completed anecdotal records and a program template. The program template has a certain amount of boxes per day split into the developmental domains. The template has to be filled in by the Monday it's due to start. There's just one spare box for a spontaneous activity to be included on the day. Underneath the boxes, there's a line of checkboxes, which includes parent participation, multicultural experience, and child initiated. Each checkbox needs to have one entry per week. As a group leader enters the experiences for the week carefully, mapping the developmental outcomes to the experience, there's just one box for the week left to fill, child initiated. The group leader reflects for a moment and remembers that
Timmy specifically went to the trucks on the shelf and brought those out to play. He initiated that play all by himself, so he must enjoy it. So, the group leader puts the trucks in the sand pit on the day that Timmy is back next week and ticks the child-initiated box. The hour's up. The group leader packs up her things and goes back to the room to start assisting the children to transition from breast to afternoon tea. The program stays inside the folder until Monday morning when it's taken out and displayed on the wall. Okay, you can open your eyes. What I need you to do now is put your critical reflection hat on and focus on the child-initiated tick box section of the scenario. I've got the reflection questions up on the slide for you now. So the first one, what does child-initiated mean to you? How did the group leader obtain information about Timmy to reach to the decision that trucks were something that Timmy would like to play with again? Will Timmy feel a sense of ownership over the truck experience next week? Why or why not? Is this an authentic or tokenistic example of children's input into the program, and what's the difference between the two? Who has the power in this program and why? And suggest some other ways the group leader could have approached the child-initiated box. So what you could do is pause the video so you can jot down your reflections, and then when you're ready, just press play again. With this information in mind, let's explore the topic of children's participation rights in education a little closer. At the end of this discussion, come back to the questions and add some more information. So Article 12 and participation. Where did this notion about children's participation rights spring from? As Monique touched on earlier, the United Nations Convention on the Rights of the Child, since its ratification in Australia in 1990, really brought children's rights into the public arena. So prior to 1989, the Declaration on the Rights of the Child was in place, and it focused purely on the provision and protection of children. In 1989, when the Convention on the Rights of the Child was adopted, alongside the already existing principles of provision and protection, participation joined the two P's as a really important element to ensure the effective implementation of the convention itself. It really significantly changed the way adults think about children, which has led to children being more involved in social and cultural contexts which directly affect their lives. As Monique also introduced us to, Article 12 within the CRC acknowledges that children are entitled to basic human rights, such as freedom of speech and to be active, involved citizens. To be an active citizen, children need to have a sense of belonging in their community, its culture, and their families to gain insight into social beliefs and values. So to feel a sense of belonging, children's opinions need to be genuinely taken into consideration and acted upon. This philosophy really underpins the participation principle and has warranted children access into typically adult-orientated arenas such as community engagement. The article which underpins this view is Article 12, among others which complement it. So with the view that children are competent human beings in the here and now, with the right and capability to contribute to matters which directly impact on them, Article 12 inherently directs adults to take a facilitation role and actively seek and action children's opinions in authentic and meaningful ways. Complementing this article is Article 13, and it states that the child shall have the right to freedom of expression. This right shall include freedom to seek, receive, and impart information and ideas of all kinds, regardless of frontiers, either orally, in writing, or in print, in the form of art, or through any other media of the child's choice. So keep in mind that for children to be active participants in any decision-making process which impacts on their lives, they're entitled to access and share information with the freedom to express what they know. Aim of children's participation is to highlight children's opinions in social and political life and to promote children as active citizens by giving children the opportunity to participate in democracy so that they can continue to use these skills as adults. Ultimately, this will influence the type of citizens children will become in the future, as it's going to foster mutual respect and trust. Participation rights in education. What is it? What is it not? The discussion previously given by Becky was the foundation to this topic, so keep this in mind as I discuss participation rights in the context of an education setting. I want you to consider the term participation and just jot down the first thoughts that come to your mind. You can pause the video at this time. The term participation conjures up various meanings which can impact on the way participation rights are implemented by teachers. For example, a dictionary definition would say that participation is the action of taking part in something. This definition often leads to adults' misconceptions about how children's participation rights in education should be successfully implemented. So what do we mean by a misconception? All children take part in action throughout the course of their day within a learning setting, but when we say participation rights, participation has a much deeper meaning. Participation rights within an education setting ensures that all children have been authentically included in the decision-making process when the outcome directly impacts on them. This interpretation is underpinned by Article 12, as previously discussed. So within the context of an education setting, all aspects will impact on children directly: the curriculum, the program, the physical environment, the resources, and the teaching strategies. As you will have seen in the Smith reading, Shear suggests the following levels which need to be considered for meaningful participation to take place. So the first one we have is children are listened to. Children are supported in expressing their views. Children's views are taken into account. Children are involved in decision-making processes. Children share power and responsibility for decision-making. Through my own research, I found another set of factors by Jerison Lansdowne, who's an international children's rights consultant. This complements Shear's model to ensure that meaningful participation in an educational setting. So the first one was an ongoing process of expression and active involvement in decision-making at different levels in matters that concern them. Information sharing and dialogue between children and adults based on mutual respect and sharing. Power for children to shape both the process and the outcome. Acknowledgement that children's evolving capacity, experience, and interests play a key role in determining the nature of their participation. So within both models, adults need to remain flexible and facilitate the projects with children as the power relationship swings back and forth. Supporting these factors in theory are Article 12 and 13, as I discussed earlier, and also Article 29, and that one states that education should develop each child's personality and talents to the full. Children have a very clear insight into their own lives and are the best source of information on matters which impact on them and can express their views, which should be given weight in the decision-making process. So let's have a look at what the research says about Article 12 and its implementation in an educational context around the world. Firstly, I want you to consider your beliefs about children, which would have informed your teaching philosophy. Would you describe children as any of the following? Capable, competent, active participants, meaning makers? Current early childhood theory and research surely confirms this. So if every teacher envisions children this way, why is there a body of research that tells us that children feel like they aren't being heard? Let's have a look at the findings, just a minute while I put my sociocultural lenses on. Overall, children are not feeling heard. As Monique stated earlier, teachers are not seeking or trusting children's opinions. They're holding the power over children as teachers select what children can have input into and what they can't within a classroom. When children do have input, it's usually obtained in tokenistic ways, which results in little to no ownership for children in matters which affect them. Other barriers include, as we discussed before, the interpretation of the term participation from an adults-only perspective and what this looks like in practice. The implications for these findings impact on the educational setting's culture, which then diminishes the student's perspective and understanding of democracy. At this point, I want you to consider the minority groups of children who would have an even greater barrier to voicing their opinions and having them taken seriously. And why would this be the case? Pause the video for a moment so you can jot your ideas down. If you jotted down children aged 0 to 5, children with a disability, Indigenous children, children who speak English as a second language, and children from refugee or humanitarian backgrounds, you would be correct. Adults' beliefs about children's lack of capacity in general has been documented as a barrier to implement Article 12 within an educational setting. Interestingly, there's also research in the fields of cognitive science joining sociologists and education experts to affirm the importance of merging ideas about how to engage learners and understanding the power relationships in schools to bring real change in support of Article 12. So, what's the point of engaging students in decision-making processes within an educational setting? The following points on this slide will explain. Children are key stakeholders in an educational setting. To earn the students' respect, respect must be given. Children are in a unique position to identify what matters to them and provide strategies for overcoming challenges. Children learn to initiate and negotiate responsibility. It improves teaching and learning and fosters democratic ethics. Children will learn to be active, informed citizens prepared to critically navigate society. Finally, let's have a look at how the research, theory, and frameworks suggest we implement this authentically. If we consider the early years learning framework, it provides us with a clear goal within outcome 2. Children are connected with and contribute to their world. How relevant is this to children's participation rights and advocating for children to be active citizens? Contemporary learning theories, such as the constructivist approach, also guides us to consider children as social actors, constructing meaning through collaborative and active discovery. In regards to the current research, there were reoccurring themes suggested to support teachers' practical understanding. This model has been taken from the Laundy reading, which encompasses the themes from the other research models. So each conclusion within the research stressed the importance of the following aspects, but just in different ways, to ensure children's participation rights are upheld. So the first one is that space. Children must be given the opportunity to express a view. So the sorts of questions you would be asking yourself would be, is there flexibility within the day to allow for meaningful conversations? Voice. Children must be facilitated to express their views. Another reflective question. Do children feel respected enough to honestly voice their opinion? Audience. The view must be listened to. How do you show children their opinions have been heard? And lastly, influence. The view must be acted upon as appropriate. So how do you engage children in each level of the decision-making process to show their opinions are being acted upon?
Hi, my name is Christy, and in this section of the presentation, I will be discussing practical examples of children's rights in an early childhood education context. When we look at children's participation rights, we need to remember that all children have these rights, and this includes our very youngest children. These formative years are not only vital in supporting children's well-being and development, but also their long-term success in future learning and, most importantly, in life. Much has been achieved for the rights of our young children in Australia through the United Nations Convention on the Rights of the Child. The United Nations Committee on the Rights of the Child has also identified where more needs to be done to advocate for our young children. Concluding observations and comments indicated that the views of children below the age of 15 are not being adequately taken into account. It was recommended that we need to continue to ensure the implementation of the right of the child to be heard in accordance with Article 12 of the Convention. This means we need to promote the meaningful and empowered participation of all children at all levels of government and within the family, community and schools, within student council bodies, with particular attention to those children that are in vulnerable situations. So how do we put the recommendations of the United Nations Commission on the Rights of the Child into practice? And what do you think could be meaningful and empowered participation? What could this look like at all levels of government within the family, community, and education context? What is holding us back from achieving more? What are some of your own barriers that limit the full potential of children's participation rights? Before we look at some of the practical examples of supporting meaningful participation rights in early childhood education contexts, it is important that we explore the barriers that we face in achieving these. So what are some of these barriers to children's voices being heard in our early childhood education context? It is the way that things have always been done. Looking deeply at the practices within organisational culture, there exists attitudes towards children reflecting an adults know best, the adult is the expert and will act in the best interest of children. We need to challenge ourselves to move beyond the traditional practices that are always done this way, because this is the way that things have been done, and move towards practices that are more inclusive of the child's voice. And this involves asking ourselves, who does it benefit when I teach this way? Children are too young and lack competence. This view reflects the belief that there is an age limitation on children's capacity. Children are considered too young to be capable of forming an opinion about decisions that affect them in their lives. It is suggested that we should assume that children have the capacity to begin with, not that it is a precondition. When we think of children having a limited capacity that is yet to develop, we in fact limit their participation level potential. This ultimately leads to children remaining passive in their participation in decision-making matters that affect them. So children only have a right to be heard when they can communicate in a way that we see fit to understand. Giving children's rights to be heard takes away their childhood. This view involves adults believing in the protection of children's innocence. Article 12 is not about obligation for children. It's about their right to participate. This means that children are not expected to participate in voicing their opinion. However, it is a right that they have if they choose to. Children will run wild. Finally, that children will run wild and implementation of Article 12 will lead to a lack of respect of adults is identified. Peter Gray, an evolutionary psychologist from the United States, argues that children are capable of educating themselves. He states that education is not new. Schooling has only been around for a few centuries and has been common for only a little over a century. Only in modern times has it been seen as the adult's job to educate children. He argues that when we have trustful and respectful ways of behaving towards children, children don't become spoiled. They become free from frustration and anxiety. He suggests that it should be a social expectation and a reality that education is children's responsibility too. Children are designed by nature to be capable of educating themselves. The more that we control or dominate children, the more that we take away this capability for them to think for themselves. Whilst there is no right way to achieve meaningful and empower participation rights, this section will help to give you some practical examples of perhaps where to start. Lansdowne describes the following four elements that are key to meaningful participation for children. These are an ongoing process of expression and active involvement in decision-making at levels about matters that concern them, information sharing and dialogue between children and adults that is based on mutual respect and sharing. Power for children to shape both process and outcomes. An acknowledgement that children's capacity is evolving. Their experience and interest are also an important aspect in determining the degree of their participation. Using the model identified by Lundy, involving four distinct elements of space, voice, audience and influence, let's take a look at some of the practical examples within the early childhood education context of how children's participation rights can be promoted. Let's take a look at space. Give children time to express their views in an unhurried way. Genuine conversations and interactions are occurring with children. Allow choice about how children will spend their time and time to deeply explore their interests. Create an inclusive and safe environment where all children are valued. Children should be able to see themselves reflected in the environment. A physical environment planned and designed to allow children to make choices and decisions. This might include open shelving, resources that can be moved between spaces, and resources available at child level. Involve children in the design and setting up of environments also. open-ended materials are available that can be used flexibly and in a number of ways. Provide children with an environment that reflects their interests and also stimulates their interests. Open environments where children can choose whether they want to be indoors or outdoors with a small group or friend or alone. Flexible arrangements for eating, rest and toileting. Allow children to make decisions about the daily routine. Opportunities to play with real tools of the culture are provided for children to experience and explore. For example, allowing children to use computers, ICTs, carpentry tools such as hammers, saws, nails, and in cooking preparation, allowing children to use knives. This shows that children's competence is valued. Voice. Some practical examples of facilitating children to express their views include access to child-friendly documentation and allowing children to express their voice through the 100 languages. So this could be drawing, painting, music, photography, construction. Involve children in making decisions about their own limits, consequences, and creating their own risk assessments. Facilitate daily meeting times or yarning circles for children to share their ideas, concerns, or just to have a yarn. Play. Now, play is not just a context for learning. It is also a context for children's participation rights. Louis Bradfield speaks of the bastardization of play, where children's voices are silenced. Bradfield, a principal of Maridati Early Childhood Community School in Toowoomba, explains that at Maridati, play implies ownership, a voice for children. He explains that children's opportunities to think for themselves and have ownership over their play decline as adults dominate children's environments. Giving children access to unstructured, free play that is also free of adult agendas is a way of giving children an opportunity to share with their teachers what it is that is important to them. And consulting children about learning and encouraging them to take ownership over their own learning. Floor books is a way that this can be achieved. Claire Warden's methodology of talking and thinking floor books is used to support child-centred planning. Children's right to be consulted and empowered as a result is at the centre of the approach. Freedom to the expression of a view can be achieved through the floor book documentation. This can be orally, in writing or print, or in the form of art or a media of the child's choice. The features of floor books include children's ideas and thoughts, open-ended questions that are provoked by the teacher, higher order thinking, depth of learning, collaborative learning, a variety of methods of presenting thinking, collating child-centred ideas, and it's available to children at all times and accessible at a level that they can also access. The ultimate purpose of a floor book is to encourage children's thinking skills through talking and listening together with others and adults so that children are consulted and can influence opportunities within the setting. Audience. Here are some practical examples of how children's views are listened to. Practicing the pedagogy of listening, and this involves deeply listening to what children are communicating, listening to their ideas and suggestions, and listening may involve looking and listening to non-verbal cues. Access to caring adults. They are there to help and care if it is needed, but not as a judge. Consider also multi-age relations, where children can have older children as an audience. And involvement of members of the community, council representatives, elders, and community workers can be involved in decision-making with children. Observing children will also allow teachers to understand the choices that children make, relationships that children develop, and also the ways in which children respond to their environment. Collaborative development with parents and teachers and the community to develop a children's rights charter that can be reinforced. And here is an example from Kowloon Children's Centre, where they implemented the collaborative development of a children's rights charter. And this is an example of a service that used democratic processes with preschool-aged children. Giving children an opportunity to vote about the decision help them to learn about their rights and responsibilities that go along with being a member of a group. The teacher discussed with the children the issue at hand and created a ballot paper that included visual representation for the children to clearly see the available options. And using stamps, the children recorded their own votes. Influence. To avoid tokenistic or decorative participation, teachers need to take children's views seriously and respond to the views that they express. We can respond to what children are telling us verbally, but we can also do so through reading their cues. For very young children, they may not be able to communicate their needs and what they want to verbally, but we can observe their gestures, behaviours and cues to respond and ensure that these views that they possess are acted upon. Some practical examples of how children's views are acted upon can include informing children of decisions that are being made and the reason why, having a responsiveness to children and being engaged teachers, involve children in evaluation and ask them questions. Do you think that worked well? What did you like? Didn't you like? Is there anything that you would like to change? Involve children in community consultation, community events, where children's voices can be amplified within the broader community context. For example, a children's photography or art event. An example of very young children making decisions about matters that affected them is given by Claire Warden in a Scotland infant setting. To consult children, the educators put three piles of clothes, uniform, real clothes, and plastic aprons. The educators then watched as the babies explored each pile of clothing one by one, and gradually they settled around the real clothes. The gestures and actions of these very young children showed preference and opinion. The children's right to be heard led the adults to change the policy to wear real clothes, as they could show through the documentation how they had given the babies an opportunity to have their voice heard. So in summary, these practical examples demonstrate how teachers in early childhood education contexts can empower children to have their voices heard in meaningful ways rather than being silenced by the barriers that we create. If we give our youngest children opportunities such as these, just imagine what could be possible for children in primary and secondary school education contexts.
Hello, my name is Alicia and I will be discussing practical examples. What does Article 12 look like in practice in a primary school setting? The spirit of Article 12, and indeed the Convention on the Rights of the Child as a whole, suggests creations of schools which are child-friendly and in which children are encouraged to be curious, to argue, to challenge, to be creative, to explore and find out, to be listened to and to be respected. Assumptions that learning automatically occurs in association with simply attending class have largely disappeared. Students do not learn much just by sitting in class and listening to teachers, memorising pre-packaged assignments and spitting out answers. However, it is still the case in so many schools to have the children sit in rows for hours and to learn what they are told to. Young children not only have a right to education, but the education provided must be rooted in respect for their rights. In this section, I will discuss some practical examples of how we can integrate child participation in our teaching practices. I'll be giving some information about how we can change our practices to incorporate children's participation and decision-making rights. There is no single method of embedding children's rights into education, and you must remember that each class will be different, as you will be engaging your students to find out their views, their passions, and what they would like to change. Lansdowne outlines the characteristics of effective and genuine participation in the table provided. This table can be used to link teaching strategies or lesson plans to key points that should be considered when respectfully engaging active and open participation in your class. Characteristics of effective and genuine participation. The project. Issue is of real relevance to children themselves. Capacity to make a difference. Where possible, produce long-term and institutional change. Link to children's direct day-to-day experience. Adequate time and resources made available. Realistic expectations of children. clear goals and targets agreed with children, addresses the promotion or protection of children's rights. Values. Honesty from adults about the project and the process. Inclusive and equal opportunity for participation by all groups of interested children. Equal respect for children of all ages, abilities, and ethnicity and social background. Information is shared with children to enable them to make real choices. Children's views are taken seriously. Voluntary nature of children's involvement. Decision making is shared. Mythology. Clarity of purpose. Child-friendly meeting places, languages and structures. Involvement of children from the earliest possible stages. Training provided to help children acquire necessary skills. Method of involvement developed in collaboration with children. Adult support provided where needed. Changing our practices to incorporate children's participation and decision-making rights in education needs to be embedded into our daily practices. These are a few practical examples of what you could do to embed children's voice in your practices. Actively listening to children's ideas, thoughts and opinions is a vital aspect. What is important to them? Don't underestimate the children in your class. They will be full of amazing insight and diverse opinions and views when it comes to their education. When beginning a project, ask children what they know, what they would like to learn, and how these goals could be achieved. Brainstorming together as a group is a great idea. Instead of the teacher single-handedly planning all the relevant ideas and educational material they feel will best relate to their students, encourage children's input by creating time each day to discuss different things. For example, issues that are affecting the students, ideas and opinions they have on current learning projects and topics, or taking the time to ask meaningful questions and advocating decision-making opportunities. Floor books could also be used, as discussed in previous practical examples section by Christy, to plan with children, ensuring they are consulted in the planning of the program and the curriculum is planned around their thinking. Teaching children about their rights. Teaching students that they have rights to participate and make decisions, to argue if they do not agree, and that their opinions and views are valid. You could do this by developing a classroom charter showing the rights and responsibilities of everyone in the class, including the right to participate, the right to learn, the right to express their views, the right to be safe, the right to be free from violence, harassment, and bullying. Give children responsibility in your classroom. Providing students with responsibilities in the classroom allows your students to feel important in the classroom. And an effective partner in the classroom and showing ownership of the room. This aspect also develops students' collaborative skills, solving problems faced without any adult involvement. These could be giving students classroom roles, for example, library monitor or tuck shop monitor, and maybe doing the new student buddy system. Trust between teacher and student. Trust that students have opinions that are valid in relation to their education. Trust students with the responsibility of using fragile equipment, for example, your cameras and things like that. Ensure that students trust you with valuing their opinions and supporting their ideas. That is a big one. Our teachers need to value children's voice and their opinions. Ensure that the opinions and decisions made by children in your class have the power to make a difference. By encouraging children to advocate and take action to implement their views in the local communities and globally. You could do this by implementing ways that students can practice their right to participate in activities that affect their community, such as making their school or home garden a better habitat for native animals. You could also do this by identifying, in consultation with Aboriginal and Torres Strait Island people or another cultural group, the importance of protecting sites of significance, as this helps protect and maintain cultural heritage. I have linked this video clip to the presentation titled Children's Voices Part 3, Children and Young People as Valued Citizens and Learners. Please take the time to watch this clip as it demonstrates a South Australian community project that engaged children from kindergarten to secondary school to design spaces in the community. The council were involved in this project, producing genuine action from the plans brought forward by the children. At this time, I would like to share a study report from Can You Hear Me? The Rights of Young Children to Participate in Decisions. A Highfield School our junior school from 7 to 11 years in a particularly deprived area of the UK. The school had been characterised by high level of violence, disaffection, bullying and truancy. A new head teacher was appointed who decided to involve the whole school community to make the school a safer and effective educational environment. In order to achieve this goal, she consulted with all the children, as well as the teachers and administrative staff, on what changes were needed to make the school a safer place. The outcomes of this consultation included the establishment of a school council in which the children had genuine power. They were involved in, for example, the development of all school policies and in recruitment of staff. The creation of a bullying box where children could, in confidence, give information about having been bullied. The appointment of guardian angels, children who volunteered to befriend children who were without friends, being bullied, or simply in need of some support. Child mediators, who would help children resolve conflict in the playground. Circle time, where children come together to raise and explore issues of current concern to them. As a result of these changes, the school became very popular. The children were happier, achieved better educational results, and acquired considerable skills of negotiation, democratic decision-making and social responsibility. This initiative demonstrates that very young children are capable of accepting considerable level of responsibility when invested with trust and support. Children can act to protect themselves and others when their rights are being respected. The provision of training and encouragement through the child mediation system enables the children to act to help each other without having to turn to adults, although the adults were available if they were needed. By respecting the rights of the children, they were then able to understand the importance of respecting the rights of others and taking responsibility to ensure this happens. Now I would like to take a moment for you all to answer some questions. Question one, how do you currently involve children's participation and decision-making rights in your classroom? How do you believe you could embed children's voice in your daily practices? What barriers do you see for the implementation of effective participation and decision-making rights in your classroom practices? And what would you need, for example, resources, professional development, information, to overcome the barriers that you've identified? Now I would like to have a look at the teaching implications. Much of the day-to-day curricular activities are primarily the responsibility of the teacher, so our commitment to a rights perspective in education has serious implications for teachers and for teacher education. Various teacher implications have been noted below. Teachers need to understand the Convention on the Rights of the Child and its implications for children's daily lives. To respect the rights of children, we as teachers may need to change our classroom behaviours significantly. Teachers have numerous responsibilities towards children. For example, we are a role model, a fundamental mentor in the learning process, and a protector of children. We need to involve the local communities and families in our teaching practices, promoting more collaboration. Our pre-service and in-service professional development for teachers is a vital and ongoing process to provide teachers with knowledge and understanding of the CRC issues. To conclude this section of the presentation, I would like to include some thought-provoking links that connect to embedding children's rights in education. These links are a Child's Rights Education Toolkit, Rooting Child Rights in Early Childhood Education, Primary and Secondary School, also the Human Rights Examples for the Australian Curriculum, Foundation to Year 10. Both of these links are full of great insight into how you can implement children's rights into your classroom and education setting as a whole.
Thank you for watching our presentation. Through the examination of a variety of significant theory and literature, we hope you now have a greater understanding of children's rights, especially in relation to Article 12 of the Convention on the Rights of the Child. By incorporating reflective questions and giving some practical examples of how we as teachers or educators, from the early childhood setting to primary education, can implement participation and decision-making rights in our classroom, has hopefully helped you to gain a variety of ideas to implement in your curriculum and teaching practices. Please refer to your one-page handout for important information and links from our presentation. Thank you.